Welcome to PayPod, the show that features thought-provoking interviews with leaders and entrepreneurs in the payments and financial technology industries. From credit card processing to Bitcoin, we cover it all. So if you want to know what's happening right now in the payments industry, stay tuned. Now, here's your host, Scott Hawksworth.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the latest episode of PayPod, the payments podcast. We have got a great show on tap for today, so let's just jump right into it. Digital security, authentication. It's so crucial to modern life, and the worlds of payment, fintech, and mobile technology are no exception. Whether you're a consumer just using your phone to complete a purchase or sign into your bank, or a business developing apps and other digital solutions that will work with sensitive data and work with users, having the best approach to security and authentication is a must. But with increased security and privacy, does user experience have to suffer? Fortunately, there are great organizations out there fighting the good fight and pushing digital security and authentication forward with user experience in mind and so much more, especially in the world of mobile. So we're going to be covering that and more on today's show with the help of my guest, Sherif Samy, who is Senior Vice President of North America for Entersekt, an innovative pioneer in mobile security, transaction authentication, and commerce enablement. He has a tremendous amount of experience and insight to share with us on all of this. So we're so lucky to have him. Sherif, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
So to start us off, can you tell us just a little bit about your career and how you ended up where you are today?
Sure. I started off a long time ago, about 10 plus years ago, in identity management, where I sort of was introduced very much into the security space and so on, very much looking at national identity schemes and building out large national identity schemes for governments, which then moved me very quickly into looking at security, authentication, payments, secure transactions, and the ability for consumers and large organizations to be able to transfer and send sensitive data back and forth and transact in a secure manner, where payments and things like that became a hot topic. I've run a number of companies and I run Entersekt in North America, which we're no different in that regard. We're very much focused on that space. So looking forward to the podcast.
Yeah, absolutely. So for those who may be unfamiliar, I kind of gave the real brief overview, but what exactly does Entersekt do in the world of fintech, payments, and beyond? What services do you offer and who do you tend to serve?
Sure. So we started off in 2008. The problem that we built our technology to solve, the problem that we were really very much addressing at the time, we're a South African-based company, by the way, and the problem we were addressing was very much focused initially in our early on in the career was around that market, and that is to remove man-in-the-middle and digital fraud from banking channels. And very much in those markets, it was a mobile-only environment. So consumers migrated, leapfrogged the desktop era and moved directly into mobile. And at the same time, SMS one-time passwords and sending passwords and all that type of stuff, sending one-time PIN codes and things like that were very prevalent in the market. Very much a lot of fraud happening there. So our first sort of conception of our technology was very much to address that. In our market in South Africa, we replaced things like SMS OTPs. We then got 80% of that market and evolved as a fintech player today, where we're in 45 countries around the world. The security layer that we built is very much the foundational layer for us to enable a platform that builds digital experiences, whether those digital experiences are in the banking and the financial institution space and wealth management with money movement and things like that, or those are in the healthcare space where you're protecting consumers' healthcare records and PII information, or in insurance, anywhere where consumers and organizations transact in a secure way, you will find Entersekt enabling technology, sort of the underlying layer to commute for communications and being able to transact securely with consumers.
That's incredible. So bottom line, you guys are all over the world and you're helping many different kinds of organizations transact more securely and transfer data and information and things like that, right?
Correct. And be able to offer digital experiences that are very advanced, using security as an enabling force for that.
And we are going to dive into that. But before we get to all that, I guess I want to just set the stage. We're talking about digital security in the world of payments, but also beyond, and mobile applications and information transfer, all of this. So let's set that stage. Why is digital security for mobile apps so important? And as a follow-up, what are some of the biggest challenges we are facing when it comes to addressing the security and this experience?
I would say digital security for mobile apps, but also for other channels, is extremely important. In the US, for example, we live in an omni-channel era, which means that consumers can transact and have the choice. And banks, for example, want to give them the choice to transact in different channels. Think of channels like the mobile app of the bank, your digital banking app, or the call center of the bank, or the web channel of the bank, or even the connected device that's in your home connected to the bank. All of these channels are areas where a consumer or a fraudster can use to penetrate the walls of a bank.
Yeah.
So protecting and securing all of those different channels has become of utmost importance, because it's not only you're going and knocking on the door of a physical store or trying to penetrate the browser to get into the bank's web channel. Fraudsters are also looking at this omni-channel experience as an opportunity for them. I could leverage all of these channels in one attack vector and do account takeovers and stuff like that as an example.
Right. It's almost like if it's a house, you know, you don't just focus on, okay, there's the front door, there's windows, there's a chimney, there's all these other ways that these fraudsters, these bad guys could get in. And they know that. They know there are all these other channels, and they're working actively to figure that out, to get in there.
Absolutely. And if you look at sort of the means that we use today to protect those channels, it's getting more and more critical because of the sensitivity of the information, because of the ability for consumers to do more high value transactions, that we have to really step up our security layers there. And the good news is there's technology that we've deployed for the last 10 years that is working, that is supporting a large number of markets around the world to mitigate digital fraud. So for example, things like today when we send one-time passwords, It's very convenient, but at the same time, it's very prone to things like man-in-the-middle attacks and phishing attacks. At the same time, even if it reaches the consumer, there's nothing that goes back to a bank or the fraud department of a bank to prove that the consumer has actually read it, opened it, and actioned it, because it's very much a fire and forget thing. So fraud goes in both scenarios: consumer saying, no, I actually didn't see this, or a fraudster intercepting it and replaying it back to the bank and taking over the relationship from the consumer.
Absolutely. So, okay, we framed the problem. Now I want to get into kind of where the rubber meets the road in terms of the security solutions and really the experience. Because anytime you talk about, you know, increased security, especially in things like mobile, but really any digital environment and so many different, places, channels where you would interact with security, there are concerns that the user experience can suffer. Anytime you're adding extra logins, lag time for verification, false failures, etc., it can be a nightmare for the consumer and the business and the bank if they're experienced, they're not serving their customers in the most effective way. So my question is what are the keys to having greater security without sacrificing user experience? And how do you guys specifically work to get security and UX to go sort of hand in hand?
Typically, when you talk about security, what goes on in organizations and people's minds is, I have to fumble with many passwords, or I have to make the password more complicated. And all of this is friction. Actually, the beauty of the technology and the beauty of the mobile device, as an example, is that it can provide a layer of security that is always with the consumer, always in their hands, and can provide ubiquity. So remove actually the friction that we're talking about. We refer to it in Entersekt in the term of healthy friction or friendly friction, in the way that it empowers consumers to be part of the transaction, to be part of the process, in a way that doesn't burden them. I don't have to enter a very lengthy, strenuous password to enter into the system. If you look again, if I go back to omnichannel, right, whether I am in a connected vehicle doing a payment transaction from my car, or I'm in a connected home now doing a transaction from an Alexa device or whatever device that I have in my home, or I'm in the branch, in a physical branch of a bank, or I'm even online, right? Mm-hmm. Wherever I am, my mobile device is in my hand. So the way we look at the world is we look at the world and say, okay, that mobile device can serve as your universal remote control in an omni-channel experience. That mobile device, if you lose it, you will know within 11 seconds that you've lost it, which serves as a possession factor in the consumer's hands. Now, if you look at it from a multi-factor authentication world, the experts say it's something you know, something you have, something you are. We take it one step further. We say, yes, all of that is correct and you need two or more. But when you use the primary factor, which is the consumer's mobile device, the possession factor in their hand, as the primary factor of authentication, and you layer in other things like biometrics and more smoother ways of frictionless authentication, mm-hmm. or behavioral, for example, you could then offer a much more richer experience to the consumer and use that mobile device, which we've locked down, to point it into the other digital channels to secure those as well. If I'm doing a sensitive transaction online, I'm moving $100,000 online, I could reach the consumer through their mobile device and say, hey, somebody is trying to move some money from your account. Is this you? If it's the consumer, then they get the empowerment to authorize that transaction and provide consent. If it's not the consumer, they have the power to say, no, I'm not doing this at the moment. Somebody else is doing it. It's an account takeover. Stop it. So there's many different ways to really secure and protect it. Leveraging that mobile device as a primary channel is where we see a lot of the value. And when you add onto it the richness and the context and the data that comes with it, you could provide a lot more of know your customer experience as well, which is opportunities that security enables.
I really love that sort of approach. It's almost like, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, you're leaning into the fact that we have these phones here that are with us, that are on our person, and saying, instead of, you know, because some people, I guess, maybe run away from it, or they try to figure out other ways. Well, what if you lean into it and then say, what a powerful thing that is, having that quote unquote universal remote control in your pocket. And what if you build things from there, right?
Absolutely. And you can then use that to offer rich experiences. So for example, you could couple payments with loyalty. You could couple payments with loyalty with the contextual things of the consumer where they are, like their location and how they behave and their state of mind at a certain moment based on the behavior. You could detect if somebody malicious is trying to do something or social engineer the attacks. Look, data's out there. Data's been breached. Our consumer data is all out there. So we have to live with the fact that somebody could create an identity on my behalf, a fake identity on my behalf, and use that to transact on my behalf, which is a fraudulent transaction. So bypassing this whole data part and binding a consumer's identity with something that's very, very strong, that's always in their pockets, always in their hands, is where we think as Entersekt the market is going, and using that to protect an omni-channel experience. So you could hand off, start a transaction from one channel, and end the transaction in another channel will offer a lot of rich experiences for consumers, which is something that we think that they'll like.
Absolutely. Now, the flip side of this, and I confess, I was thinking about this the other day, the fact that we have these cell phones, that they offer so much power, as you're mentioning, the potential there for an omni-channel experience. And with these cell phones, you can do some banking, you can communicate with friends and family, play a video game with someone halfway around the world. Yet, they're on our person, but we also have some inherent security risks with that, where we travel around and there's unsecured Wi-Fi network connections. We have Bluetooth connections. I won't get into the Apple's whole AirDrop. I'm in Chicago. There are horror stories on public transit of what people will do on AirDrop. Will these sort of inherent security risks always be a thing when it comes to mobile phone? Is there a risk that when you're kind of building it into this universal remote control, that there are still now functionally, there is just so much power. And if you can just get into the phone, then you kind of have access to that remote control, even if you don't have the physical phone.
That's exactly what Entersekt solved years ago. And the way we do it is we live inside, for example, let's take the mobile phone and let's take the mobile app as an example. Think of a digital banking app. We live inside that digital banking app. And the first things that we do is we detect that has the device been rooted, jailbroken? Is there malicious code on the device? Is the integrity of the device and of the application, has it been compromised in any shape, way, or form? Has anybody inserted malicious code in the actual banking app itself? We then live behind the organization's firewall or in their cloud with gateways and hardware security modules, and we're what we call a certificate authority. So that enables us to create a consumer's identity, bind the consumer's identity with their device, make sure that the integrity of that device, integrity of the application hasn't been compromised, and to handle things like unsecure Wi-Fi and communication channels, we actually open a separate communication channel between the mobile application, mobile device, and behind the organization's firewall. So think of the analogy of opening like a VPN tunnel between consumer's mobile application device and behind the organization's firewall. And that's how we eliminate things like man-in-the-middle and phishing attacks. When we first deployed our technology 8 years ago and replaced things like SMS one-time passwords, we reduced 100% fraud from the bank's digital channels through this technology. Fraudsters migrated to all the other banks. They came to us in our home market in South Africa, the banks, and they deployed our technology. And that's how we got 80% of the South African market, as an example.
Wow, that's great. You solve that. And then, of course, you see how the banks say, hey, this is a great solution for us. And it's making the fraudsters go elsewhere. So why wouldn't you want to be on that? And so actually, with that in mind, you know, we've kind of mentioned banking a few times so far. And mobile banking is something that continues to grow. As a result, so have the security needs. And there's a lot for banks to navigate. You have tokenization, app-to-app payment rails, 3D secure, issuer wallets, and more. There's so much when it comes to, you know, under that umbrella of mobile banking. I'm curious, how are banks doing in general with all of this? And how does Entersekt help banks get even better and navigate everything more expertly when they are trying to improve their mobile banking experiences?
So traditionally, mobile banks, and even today, mobile banks and banks in general, they have to deal with many demographics of consumers, especially here when you talk in the US. Not all consumers in the US are going to be mobile app users, right? Not all consumers in the US are going to go to the web channels of the bank. Some prefer to go to the call center. Some prefer to go in branch physically. It depends on the demographic, if you're a millennial, or if you're a baby boomer, or if you're tech savvy, you're not. So the first thing the banks tell us is they have to deal with all different grades of consumers, and it needs to be basically more choice. So what we do is we go and look at all of these channels for the bank, and we go and build the same level of grade security to protect all the other channels. So we do things like call center authentication, where we reduce, on the one hand, the need to go through a strenuous know your customer KYC process, with what's your mother's given name and what's your favorite food. Well, everybody knows that 80% of people's favorite food is pizza, right? And through Facebook and social engineering, you will detect all that as a fraudster. So we look at things like call center authentication. We look like things like securing the web channel itself and securing the mobile application, and then leveraging that mobile application to do things like, okay, I'm at the branch, allow me to check in at the branch. Mm-hmm. Right, with my mobile channel. Then you're handing off from one channel to the other channel. I'm online and I want to transfer some money. Can I inform the consumer to make sure that it's actually him that's online? Because 99% of the case, he'll have his mobile device in his hands. And then after we've done all that, can we then transact more richer with the consumer? Can we not only inform them that a transaction has happened and they're what we call card controls, but then rich information about the transactions and the card controls that have happened. And not only that, allow the consumers to respond and give me instructions back. For example, we could inform the consumer that they've approached 30% of their credit card spend, and that impacts their credit score. So the bank is a good custodian helping the consumer with their credit score. On the other hand, as part of that communication, they could entice the consumer to pay part of that credit card bill down. And with one push of the button, the consumer can give instructions and customer consent to the bank that enables them to do payments and things like that. When you add privacy to the mix and customer consent, and you look at things like regulations like in California and Europe with GDPR, You have to build a very strong customer consent engine that offers non-repudiation. Those are all the things that we solve for. And even in Europe, when we get there and we start talking about PSD2 and open banking, we provide PSD2 compliance and open banking sort of concepts here in the US as well, capabilities and so on.
Absolutely. Everything you're talking about is really the importance of this total experience and kind of thinking about all the different ways that consumers interact with a bank, for example, and all the different things that they want to do and how the underlying technology that's also secure can make everything more seamless, more secure, and then obviously results in a happier customer, which is great.
Absolutely. If the consumer feels empowered that they're part of the journey, if they feel empowered that the bank is taking their opinion or any organization is taking their opinion before they share their information and tells them what their boundaries are and allow the consumer to provide rich responses back and at the same time protect the consumer and give them a rich customer experience, that's really where we're heading in the markets and then looking at it from multiple channels. That's a lot of the conversations that are happening with the bank. I mean, we're having conversations with banks today on how do you onboard an unknown consumer to your bank so you don't know anything about this consumer, onboard them and make them into a banking customer and issue them payment credentials and cards and fund their accounts without them having to go to the branch to do it from their mobile device in less than 3 to 5 minutes. Those are things which will make consumers very, very happy to transact with those banks.
Absolutely. Biometric-based authentication is something that I'm personally fascinated by. I think it's a great alternative to password authentication. Still, you know, especially and when you think about the potential applications for payments and things like that, there's a lot of potential there. But still, it seems like we're only scratching the surface of it overall. I know for me personally, I use my thumbprint to get into my phone, but not much else. I'm curious, what kinds of applications of this biometric-based authentication and this technology is Entersekt seeing?
We embrace all different biometric types. We've got what we call pluggable biometric capabilities because every biometric is going to have its own use case and its own level of security. Whether you're talking about behavioral biometrics, which is AI on your behavior, or you're talking about I'm using my fingerprint or my face or any of that, all of these technologies have their use cases and we sort of support the entire gamut there. The one thing that I always say is, biometrics on their own are good from a frictionless perspective, but you need what we call the possession factor. You need the root of trust because everybody has seen that if you take a high resolution image of your thumb, you can unlock somebody's phone with it. Or you go on websites like Lyrabird and you could get 30 seconds of somebody's voice print and everybody's on YouTube now, right? You could do instructions on their behalf. So it's a layered approach. But at the same time, when you start with the possession factor, with the trust, sort of the trusted source, which in our case, we look at it as the mobile device to start with, or the web channel, for example, your desktop device or whatever other device, if you start that and lock that down and then add all the other factors like biometrics, you have a much more richer, much more secure experience. And so that's why we cater for all the different types of biometric modalities as well.
So it's really part of the suite almost as opposed to a means to an end. But it leads to a question that I have is there's always a news story about how everybody has password 123 and all these kinds of things and the difficulty of everybody trying to remember different passwords. Do you think that in the future we could ultimately see passwords being just an extreme rarity and everything is either biometric based or a mix of that and other authentication? Or do you think that biometrics is really only a piece of it and can make it better, but you know, passwords are still going to be a core?
We are already working on solutions which we call passwordless login solutions that does not require any password whatsoever. Again, your device could be your password. Your fingerprint can be your password. A combination of all of the above can be your password, right? So we absolutely see a world where passwords are non-existent. I mean, we've had in payments here in what we call card not present payments, there was a pretty secure specific solution, which was sort of the first initial version of a 3D secure one. That didn't take off in countries like the US because the consumers had to fumble with username and password and they forgot them. And there's different ones for the different cards that I have in my pocket, depending on the brand. 3D Secure 2 is coming out now, which is card-not-present payments, online payments, that is offer a much more ubiquitous, passwordless experience. And we're seeing that obviously to be the future as well. So these solutions are out there. We're deploying them every day as well.
Now, Entersekt also offers solutions for digital signing, which is so huge. In e-commerce, for example, one of the big ways to combat chargebacks and authenticate secure transactions is needing digital signatures. Could you share just a bit about the power of digital signing at a high level and how Entersekt helps empower businesses with it? Are you seeing more and more e-commerce businesses kind of opt for participating in this?
One of the good things that we built a long time ago and we've been very successful with is we are a certificate authority, which means that whenever we bind consumers' identities with their devices, we are able to give them different types of digital certificates. And those digital certificates can be used for signing many things. One is signing transactions. So that provides a level of what we call non-repudiation, because we can do things in sort of a very secure manner, because we could prove mathematically that a specific person, individual, or a specific account has done something, which helps organizations in fraud scenarios. We could provide customer things like customer consent, which is very important when you talk about privacy at the moment. I, as a consumer, am required now and require to consent that somebody uses my information. You need to sign and digitally sign that customer consent to organizations. Other things which we're also looking at is things around document signing. If I can open a bank account, everything virtually and digitally online, why can't I sign for that bank account or sign for a specific product online as part of my encompassing experience? So all of these signing capabilities, whether they're transaction-based or document-based, are all part of the conversation that the industry is having and part of the conversations that we're having with the industry as well.
All right. We're almost at the end here. My big question here is, can you peer into the crystal ball? What do you see in the future for Entersekt? Any specific technologies or products on the horizon? And we've touched on a few, but that you can share that our listeners might find to be particularly interesting or really impactful.
I think what we call ubiquitous payments is definitely something that we're seeing, the ability to empower a banking application. So today, what do I mean by it, right?
Yeah.
Consumers have to fumble with many different apps, like they're fumbling with many different passwords, in order to do a specific function, right? Whether that function is paying or banking, and many different applications to do different types of payments. What we looked at is, how could we make this even simpler to consumers? And one thing that we've done, for example, is in some markets around the world, whether you're scanning a QR code, you've got many different types of QR codes, right, that a consumer has to scan. And each one of those has its own app. Mm-hmm. You could tap your phone and each type of payment app is different and different experiences. We look at things which we call ubiquitous payments. And why don't you have one button in your banking app that you scan whatever QR code it is, whether it's from whatever merchant it is, that application, that banking app just understands it, or it could be a commerce app, right? That understands it, translates it, and does not require you to fumble into all sorts of different other applications. Really something that makes the consumer less confused with all the different experiences that are out there. So we're seeing that as big. Another area we're seeing that's very big is much more richer digital experiences and a more dialogue in the digital space with consumers. At the moment, I just push information to the consumer, and the consumer asks me questions and inquires about things. Why not a bidirectional relationship, a secure bidirectional relationship in the digital space, exactly like I'm having a dialogue in the physical space?
Wow. I'm excited to see all of that. And I think there's some real amazing innovations as we move forward with that. So, okay, we have a segment that we like to end with on each and every show, which is 5 questions, rapid fire. Are you ready?
Sure. Let's go for it.
Make a prediction about the future of mobile security, either payments related or not, that you expect will happen in the next 12 to 24 months. So pretty near term.
Replacement of things very near term, like SMS one-time passwords and separate authentication apps, really something that is very ubiquitous and removes things like man in the middle and phishing attacks, stuff like that. That's something we're seeing today.
What's one cool piece of payment-related technology you've come across recently, unrelated directly to your company, that impressed you?
I think really what we call sort of cross-channel payments and coupling payments with loyalty into, again, one experience. That's something that sort of we're seeing. The ability for multiple organizations to exchange payments and loyalty together as sort of like a network effect type of thing. We're seeing very, very in its infancy, but happening.
In the next 5 years, most Americans will make a purchase with either Bitcoin, Apple Pay, some other thing. Which one and why?
All of the above. I think cryptocurrencies has its consumers and people are buying with it today. Apple Pay with the acceptance infrastructures increases will be the same thing. Paying with their banking wallet and peer-to-peer payments is coming up fairly heavy. Faster payments is coming up. All of these things are happening and we're going to start seeing them in the near future as well.
What's one piece of advice you would have for someone who's considering the fintech or digital security industry as a career?
It is a very, very hot industry at the moment because there's a lot of disruption with fintech and financial technology and financial inclusion that it definitely warrants a lot of sort of bright minds to join the industry. When you couple that with security, there's a lot of balancing acts when you talk about security. What is good enough security? How much money am I willing to spend on security? But being able to look at security as an enabler for digital innovation is a different perspective that we don't see a lot of organizations or a lot of people thinking through. And we see that as sort of the next big thing. And from that perspective, the more people that are embracing that, the better it is for our industry.
Last one, what's the best business advice you've ever received and from whom?
Oh gosh, I've got a lot of good business advice. I think the best one that I've been living by a lot is listen to your customers and listen to the market. And don't think that you have the silver bullet because practical life comes in the middle. So being able to understand what the real problems are and adapt fast is sort of the best business advice that I've received.
Sherif, I wanted to thank you so, so much for joining me today. This was a fantastic exploration of the world of digital security and mobile and things like user experience. These are all challenges and obstacles that clearly you guys are working to overcome and making great strides. And it's going to be exciting to see how it continues into the future. So thank you again for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
And where can folks go if they've been listening and they want to connect with you or Entersekt or learn more?
Absolutely. So Entersekt is www.entersekt.com with a K at the end, KT at the end. So look us up. You'll find us. There's a lot of people in our company that will be willing and happy to talk with everybody and share knowledge. And you'll find me on LinkedIn or other channels. So happy to connect with anybody.
Absolutely. Thanks again.
All right. Thank you very much.
So that completes our show today. Thanks so much for listening. And don't forget to subscribe if you like the show. You can do so on iTunes, Google Play, and many other platforms. So until next time, I'll see you then. And thanks again for listening.
Thank you for listening to another episode of PayPod, brought to you by Soar Payments. Soar Payments is a leading merchant services provider for e-commerce, high-risk, and hard-to-place businesses. If you'd like to get the latest PayPod episode sent to you automatically, subscribe to the show via iTunes or Stitcher, or visit soarpay.com/podcast.